All right, this is going over the worksheet, section 2.3 review worksheet. I'm taking a quiz on this stuff tomorrow, so listen up, write it down if you didn't know how to do it, and watch the video tonight if you still don't get it today. All right, which ones are we doing? Three. Okay. What else? Eight. All right, that's a good one. What else? Are you getting that 10 to 13 stuff? Wasn't too hard, was it?
It's just one without four.
It's a multiple of four?
Yeah.
Yep. What about 14 and 15? Let's do one of those. Both of them or one of them? Okay, 14. They're about the same, aren't they? I don't think one's any more difficult than the other. That's it? That's all the questions you had? Wow. Everybody must get 100 on this quiz then, right? I hope. All right, let's try this. Number three. Square root negative 15. Square root negative 5 over square root of 3. All right. What do you think? What do you think the first thing that you want to do is on this? Any ideas? Do you want to multiply 15 times 5? Is that what you want to do? Maybe it's what you want to do, but if you think that's the best thing, I don't know. What do you think, Ryan? Good question. Well, every time we've done a problem with a square root of a negative number, we always did this first, every time we've done one of these. What was it? Destiny, tell us. Yeah, let's get rid of that square root and make it turn it into an I. All right, that's the first thing I'm going to do. All right, so if you see a negative inside the square root, you have to get rid of it, and that's this. That's been this whole chapter so far, or this whole section anyway, section 2.3, is that square root of negative 1. So we have to get rid of that square root of a negative. So what happens when you have a negative inside a square root? It turns into what? An I. And then what do we have left? Square root of 15. So that's the first thing we want to do, okay, is change that square to negative 15 so it doesn't have a negative inside the square root. And we do that by making that negative 1, into an I, because the square root of negative 1 is I. Do the same thing here. Look at that. We're going to take that negative inside the square root, make that into an I. So that negative turns into an I on the outside, and you just have the square root of 5 left over. We good with that? And that's over square root of 3. So that's the first thing you want to do. Every single time you see a square root with a negative inside of it, you want to get that negative out of there and turn it into an I. That's very important. Now we can do a couple things on this next step. Let's do this first. Let's do the I's. I times I. So I times I becomes I squared, which is negative 1. Right. So I times I is negative 1. So we'll just put a negative out in front. Isn't that a negative 1? If you just stick a negative out in front? Okay. Now what about this? Square root of 15 times the square root of 5. Some people look at this and say, well, let's just multiply them together and put them under the square root. Yeah, I guess that's a possibility. But I see stuff. I'm kind of looking ahead a little bit. I'm looking at my numbers. I see a 3 or a square root of 3. I see a square root of 5 here, and I see a square root of 15 here. What do you think you might, what do you think is the easiest way to do this? That's right. Break up that 15. Okay. Now, again, you could technically go square root of 15 times square root of 5 is what? The square root of 75, I think, is 15 times 5, isn't it? So you could do that. But I think it's a lot easier just taking that square root of 15 and breaking it up. So if I break it up, what do I get? I get the square root of 5 times what? 3. Square root of 3, right? Everybody see that? Now, how did I know to do that? Because I just kind of look ahead a little bit, don't I? I look at this and I say, oh, I see a square root of 3 on the bottom, square root of 15. I'm thinking, okay, 5 times 3, square root of 5 times square root of 3. Guess what happens with that square root of 3 and this square root of 3 right here? They cancel each other out. That's right. All right? So you got to, sometimes you got to look ahead a little bit to see what the best approach to that problem is. And then now that's just square root of 15, but we still have that square root of 5 here. We don't want to forget. And then on the bottom, we have the square root of 3. Does that make sense? I think that's a little easier, don't you, than making the square root of 75? I mean, you could, but watch what happens. The square root of 3 cancels out. Look what happens here. What's the square root of 5 times the square root of 5? Just plain old 5, but you got that negative out in front, so what's your answer? It's just negative 5. Just like that. All right, it's just a matter of learning your rules, isn't it? Remembering your rules, I guess, is probably the best thing. We've learned all these rules before. It's just remembering what to do. And again, sometimes there's easier ways to approach a problem than another way. Again, you could have gone square root of 15 times square root of 5 is square root of 75, and then you could have broken square root of 75 down. Let's just do that. So this would have been, you got a negative out here, and you got this. So look, what's the square root of 75? Well, the square root of 75 is what, 25 times 3, isn't it? Everybody see that? Why am I writing up a hill? I don't know why. So square root of 3. So what's this? You got still got the negative out in front. What's the square root of 25? Just 5. And then you got a square root of 3. What happens to this square root of 3 and this square root of 3? They cancel out, and then you get the same answer, don't you? If you wanted to do it that way, that's perfectly fine. I kind of like this way better. I like breaking it down, seeing that they cancel out right off the bat. Either way is perfectly good way to do it. All right, enough of that. Number 8. I think we covered everything good there, don't you? I don't think we left anything out. I don't think I skipped over anything, went over every little step. All right, look at number 8. So we've got an I out in front, and you got a couple parentheses being multiplied together. So what's the word that comes to mind when you see this? When you see two parentheses, two sums being multiplied times each other like this? What's the word? It stands for 4 different words. Come on.
Foil?
Foil, yeah. Okay, I'm thinking foil here, aren't I? But you take a little closer look at it, and what is this? This and this are the same, except this is plus and this is minus. So what kind of special foil, what kind of special multiplication is it? Ajay, tell us. It's a difference of two squares, right? So if it's a difference of two squares, it saves you a little bit of, you know, work, right? But you could just do regular foil. That's what I would do first. I would not multiply this by an I first. I would wait to the very end to multiply it by this I. I think it's way easier taking these two parentheses, figuring out what that is, and then multiplying that by the I. Does that make sense? Now, you could, if you wanted to, you could have taken this I, multiplied it by this, and then taken that answer and multiplied it by this. That would have been okay. I think it's easier. I personally think it's easier to do this stuff first, and then at the very end, we'll multiply it by the I. So let's do that. So here's an I, and let's figure out what this is going to be. Now, if it's a difference of two squares, remember what we do? Multiply the first and multiply the last. The outside and inside will add up to 0. All right, so let's do that. Let's multiply the first together, which is a 9, and let's multiply the last together, because again, the outside and inside will add up to 0. So the last is a negative. 5 times 5 is 25, and I times I is I squared. I know some of you guys might be able to do that in your head, but there's a few steps we had to do, so I'm just going to play it safe and just show the step. Is that all right? If you do too much in your head, sometimes you get confused. I know I do if I do too much in my head. So I like to write down little steps. So let's see what we get. Let's simplify the stuff in here. Now, at this point, now I can do a couple things in my head here. This I squared becomes what? What is it? Negative 1. Good. So this is a negative 1. So it's negative 25 times negative 1 becomes what? Plus 25. Can we do the rest of it in our head? This is going to be 9 plus 25. Or should I just put it down? Let's just put it down. I don't want to go too much in my head, but we'll do this. So what is 9 plus 25?
34.
And then I just write it. You could write it like that, I guess. But it's a lot nicer if you just write it like this. 34i. So that multiplying by the I thing was pretty easy, wasn't it? Because we figured out all this stuff. It just came out to a nice whole number, 34. Then you just stick it next to the I and you're good to go. Wasn't that a lot easier than taking the I and trying to distribute it through one of these? Yeah. You know what a mistake a lot of people make? They take this I and they try to distribute it through everything here. No, you only take this I and multiply it by one of these things, right? Watch this. What if you had this? 3 times 4 times 5. What if you did that? Do you distribute that 3 through this? No, you just take that 3 and you just multiply by one of these, don't you? Right? You don't go 3 times 4, then 3 times 5, do you, if you're multiplying that together? No, you would do what? You'd go 3 times 4, right, which is 12, times 5. Make sense? So if you were going to distribute this I through here, you just distribute it through this one, and then take that answer and multiply it by this. I think that's more difficult. I like the way that we did it right there better. All right, what was the last one? Let's see. 14. Let's go blue. 14. Let's see that. Okay, I picked this one, didn't I? Three minus two I. Okay, it says to simplify. Somebody tell me. Alex, tell me, why is this not simplified? Because you got an I on the bottom. Very good. Okay, you got the I on the bottom. Ashley, help me out. What am I going to do? Give me a special math word that we use all the time. We multiply. Tiffany, you're cheating. Right, multiply by the conjugate. All right, so I multiply by the conjugate. I don't just multiply by an I, do I? Because I've got a sum right here. I got stuff that's being added or subtracted. So I have to multiply by the conjugate. This is not the first time we've seen this. We had another chapter, another lesson a while back. We've been testing on it already that we had to multiply by conjugates. So that shouldn't be new to you. Now, having the I there, that's a little bit new. But we know how to work with the I. That shouldn't be a big deal. Now, if I multiply the bottom by 3 plus 2i, I also have to multiply the top by 3 plus 2i. Why do I do that? Why do I multiply the top and the bottom? Is there a rule that says whatever we do to the bottom, we do to the top? Is there? Oh, come on. We've had a lot of talk about, yeah, I talk about this all the time, right? There's not a rule that says whatever we do to the bottom, we do to the top. For instance, if I squared the bottom, I can't just square the top. There's no rule that allows me to do that. Would you agree with that? Watch this. What if I did this? What if I squared the bottom and squared the top? Do I get the same exact answer as this? If I square the top, I get 4. If I square the bottom, I get 9. Is 2/3 the same as 4/9? No, it's not. So there is no rule that says whatever I do to the bottom, I do to the top. But there is a rule that says this. I can multiply anything by a 1, and it's not going to change the value. So the reason I multiply the top and the bottom by the same thing is it turns this into a 1. Make sense? All right. Just wanted to clear that up because that's a common mistake people make all the time. All right, let's do it down here. Let's do the bottom. Multiply the bottom together. We're multiplying by a conjugate, so that's nice. So all we got to do is do the first and the last. We did this earlier in the other problem. 3 times 3 is 9, and then negative times positive is negative. Tell you what, let's do this in our head now. We showed the steps on the other problem. Let's kind of do a little bit in our head. It's 2 times 2, which is 4. I times I, which is I squared. I squared is negative 1. So what does that make this? It makes this a plus. So I did a little bit in my head right there, didn't I? Right? I showed the steps in the earlier problem, but on this one, I think you might be able to get away with it. Negative times positive is negative, but I times I is I squared, which is a negative. Negative times negative is positive. Hope you followed on that. Now let's do the top. Now the top is not a conjugate of each other, so we're going to have to go through the whole entire FOIL method on this, which is not that big of a deal. First outside, inside, last. So the first is 21. The outside is 14i. The inside is 15i. And then the last is, let's do this. Let's do a little bit of this in our head. 5 times 2 is 10. I times I is I squared, which is negative 1, which makes this a minus 10. Getting used to that now? Okay, when you see that I times I, you know it's going to be a negative, negative 1. And we're almost done. Let's do the top. 21 minus 10, that's what? 11. I always do the reals first, remember that? Then we'll do the imaginary second. 14i plus 15i is 29i, so it's plus 29i. Then the bottom is just 13, and that's your answer right there. And I'm perfectly fine if you leave their answer like this. But again, like I said, some teachers, maybe in the future, you'll have a teacher that makes you write it like this if you ever see this stuff again. It's really no different, is it? Just found one common denominator here, and I just split them up into two different, well, it's the same denominator, but two different fractions. Either way, this is the way the book does it right here. I'd be fine either way. We good with that? Is there anything else? It's last chance. Go ahead. Yeah, yeah. Pick one. Which one you want to do? 13, okay. Oh, yeah, that's a good one. I to the 73rd power. Let's review a little bit. Remember what I to the first is? It's just I, isn't it? Okay, what's I to the second, or I squared? It's negative 1. What's I cubed? Remember that? It's negative I. And then what was I to the fourth? It was positive 1. All right, it repeats that pattern. Every 4 times you go around, it repeats that pattern, doesn't it? So what do we look at? This is the one that we're really looking at right there, is I to the fourth. So anytime you have a exponent to an I that is a multiple of 4, it's always going to be a positive 1. So what does that mean? It means I to the fourth is 1. So what's I to the eighth going to be? 1. What's I to the 12th going to be? 1. What's I to the 48th going to be? 1. Why did you know that off the top of your head? Because 48 is what? It's a multiple of 4. Okay? How do you know something's a multiple of 4? Do you really have to sit there and take that number, like 48, and then divide it by 4? To find out if it's a multiple of 4, if you can divide it by 2 and then divide that by 2, then it's a multiple of 4, isn't it? Because you're dividing by 4. So if you have, first of all, you got to have an even number, right? Divided by 2 in the first place. And then whatever you get after dividing by 2, if that's an even number, everybody see that? So let's take a look at this. First of all, 73, is that even divisible by 2? No. So you know it's not divisible by 4. But let's go a little smaller. Let's try 72. Okay, is 72 divisible by 2? Yeah. Obviously, because it ends in that. You know what, you should know what that is off the top of your head. What's that off the top of your head? 72 divided by 2, you don't know that number? 36? That's not familiar to you? No? That's just one of those. I don't know why 72, but I mean, it's just one of those that just is in my head. What about 36? Is 36 divisible by 2? Yes, it is. So what is this? So I to the 72nd times I to the 1st is the same thing as I to the 73rd. Agreed? Is I to the 72nd divisible by 4? We don't even care how many times it goes into it, do we? All we care is it divisible by 4? Yeah, it is. So if this is divisible by 4, then it's just a 1, isn't it? Cancels out, if you want to consider it canceling out. You could always use your calculator too, couldn't you? Put a number in there, divide it by 4, and see if it comes out even. If it comes out even, then you're good to go. All right, so what are we left with then? It's just I, and then that's your answer. So I to the 73rd is the same exact thing, it's just I. All right? See how it repeats that pattern again? Because right here, this would kind of be like your I to the 72nd, wouldn't it? But then what do? We go back to here, and then this would be I to the 73rd. This would be I to the 74th, I to the 75th, I to the 76th, and it keeps on going, right? Does that make any sense? Let's do another one. Give me another one that doesn't come out to an I. Just pick one. 12, okay. So I to the 38th. I to the 38th. First of all, it's an even number, right? So it's a possibility that could come out to, it divisible by 4. It's a possibility, but let's try it. 38 divided by 2. Anybody know what that is off the top of your head? Oh, I wrote 32. 38 divided by 2 is 19. Is 19 divisible by 2? No, it's not. All right. So 38's not. So 37, go a little lower. Is 37 divided by 4? No. What about 36? Yeah, now that should be a number that's in your head, right? Because that's one of your multiplication tables. So it's I to the 36 times I to the what? Second, right? Everybody see that? So that's what I do. I look at this number first, see if it's divisible by 4. If it's not, I go back one. If that's not, I go back another one. If that's not, I go back another one and see if they're divisible by 4. Then I write it like this. So I to the 32nd times I squared is I to the 38th. What's true about I to the 36th? That's divisible by 4, isn't it? All right? And again, you should know that because your multiplication tables, right? 9 times 4 is 36. So that's a 1. This is I squared. But we don't write the answer I squared. What is I squared equal to? It's negative 1. That should be an easy one. So it's just negative 1. And that's your answer right there. So I to the 38th is the exact same thing as just a negative 1. Thing is, you can't do this on a calculator, can you? You don't have an I button on your calculator. It'd be nice if you just stuck in I to the 38th, but you don't have it. You got to know the rules. You got to know what to do, all right? And you got to know this stuff right here. We good? Anything else? All right, so you should be Should be good for the quiz, right? We'll take it. Shouldn't take too long. We're not going to take the whole period tomorrow on it. We'll just take the very first few minutes of class tomorrow to go over the quiz, and then we'll start the new lesson, 2-4. All right? Make sure you bring that homework, that 2-3 review with you tomorrow. We'll turn that in tomorrow. Take the quiz, do the next lesson, give you new homework. Now, we still have all this week, all right? This is not going to be a messing around week. This is going to be academic, we're going to work every day type of week. So I know we're getting close to Christmas. Look, I'm feeling it too, believe me, okay? I'm feeling it, and your teachers are feeling it too. But we're going to, you know, the reason we're in charge is to push you along a little bit and not let you just goof off until Christmas break, all right? So let's work hard. Forget about Christmas when you're in school, okay? And then when you go home, you can look at all the lights and all the pretty stuff and listen to your music. But let's work hard all the way to the end, okay? That's it.